to stand up as we sing, Christ the Lord is risen. Sing, I cast my mind.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
Body bound,
his body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all
for With joy and gladness, let us go to God in prayer. Risen Lord, we recall the days leading up to the cross. And what we discover is a God not afraid to kick up a little dust, one willing to leave a trail of blood and tears behind, one who takes on death and all matters of darkness, one willing to be bound to chains so that we don't have to. We rejoice that in your power, death no longer has a say. That through your life, every crucifying power is put to death. So we breathe. We breathe in love and new life. We breathe in liberation and freedom. We cherish and adore all of creation. We live with your resurrecting power surging through us. You are our Savior. Our Savior with wounded hands and feet. And with everything in us this morning, we give you all the praise. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, we pray. Amen. Let us recite our Easter litany printed in your bulletin. O God, early in the morning, when the world was young, you have made life in all its beauty and terror. You gave birth to all we know. Thank you, God, for your creative goodness. Early in the morning, when the world least expected it, a newborn child crying in a manger announced that you had come among us, that you were one of us. Thank you, God, for coming to be among us, living in our lives, knowing our pain, and experiencing our joy. Early in the morning, surrounded by self-interested religious leaders, anxious civic officials, and silent friends, you accepted the penalty for doing good, for being Emmanuel, God, with us. You shouldered, carried, and suffered the cross while those about you jeered and cheered. And it concerns us, dear God, with whom you stood and have been there on that perilous day. Early in the morning, a voice in a guarded graveyard and footsteps in the dew proclaimed that you had risen from the dead, announced the startling news that you had come back to claim as your beloved own those who had forgotten, denied, and destroyed you. Thank you, God, for such death-defeating, extravagant love. On this resurrection day, we dare ask you to pry open our hearts to let such love transform and change us, this and every day. Amen.
Sing this together. Holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy.
please be seated. At this time, I would like to welcome our youngest disciples to come on forward for a little bit of time together. I have a feeling there's a lot of you today. And if you're worshiping with us online, this time is for you too. Yeah, y'all come on and get close. Friends, oh my goodness, you're still coming. There are a lot of you today. I feel a little nervous right now. Well, I'm so excited to see you guys today. It is a really special day in the life of the church, and you might notice some things in the sanctuary that tell you it's a special day. It might even feel special because there are so many people here. And I thought today we could play a little game together, a little word game. Are you ready? Give me a thumbs up if you're ready to play a little word game. I see lots of thumbs up. Okay, we're gonna start out pretty easy, okay? So I want you to fill in the blank. If I say happy, you say?
Happy.
Let's try that one more time and get our energy up. Happy?
Easter.
All right, let's try a little bit harder one. If I say Easter, you say?
Bunny.
Good. Okay, do you want to do a silly one?
Yes.
Okay. If I say jelly, you say?
Jelly bean.
Jelly bean. Yeah, I love jelly beans. Okay, we're going to get a little harder. You think you can handle it?
Yes.
You think you can handle it?
Yes.
If I say empty, you say
tomb.
Empty what?
Tomb.
Empty tomb. And this last one, I actually don't have a picture for, but I want to see if you can do it. If I say he is, you say?
God.
Oh my gosh, I hear two different things and they both work. I hear risen and I hear alive. He is risen and he is alive. Let's try it with he is risen. I'll say he is and you say?
Risen.
All right, we're going to do it one more time really loud. I want everyone way up there in the balcony to hear you. He is?
Risen!
That's right, and that is what we celebrate today. You will hear people say, Happy Easter. You might have seen an Easter bunny yesterday. You might even eat some jelly beans. I think I probably will. But what we celebrate today is that the tomb is? The tomb is
empty,
and he is
risen.
That's right. And because Jesus Christ is risen, we are promised new life and hope and joy and goodness. And for this, we are so thankful. Will you guys say a little prayer with me? You can repeat after me. Dear God,
thank you for the good news
that Jesus is risen.
Help us to share this good news
and to be changed by it
all the days of our lives.
Amen. All right. Thank you guys for spending some time with me. You can head on back to your seats with your grown-ups or head on to childcare. Well, friends, on this Easter Sunday, what a joy it is to be together, both with the children of this church, but also with each and every one of you. If you are visiting with us today, we are delighted to have you with us. And you might be scrunched into the pews, but we're so glad that you are. So thank you for being with us today. And we hope that you sense a warm word of welcome here and that you'll linger after the service to enjoy a bit of fellowship with one another. whoever you are and however you've made your way to us this morning, whether that's in person or online, we hope that you'll take a moment to fill out the worship response card, which is tucked just inside your bulletin. You'll notice on there that there is a place to share some contact information so that we can be in touch with you in a personal way following this service. And there's also a place for you to leave prayer requests or to indicate an area that you might like to plug into at this church. I assure you, there are lots of ways for you to share your gifts, and I feel confident that you would also be met with gifts. Each Sunday, Covenant enjoys welcoming new members during a joining meeting that takes place at 10:30 in the parlor. This meeting is a celebration of growth in faith and growth in community. And if you are interested in joining this community of faith, an usher or I would be happy to help you find your way to the parlor. We did have one new member last week, Jody Malone, pictured here with her daughter. Jody has been around and involved at Covenant for some time now, so please just continue to extend your kindness and your hospitality to her. As we gather for worship, we pause to remember that we are the body of Christ. And we also pause to act on that remembrance, remembering that the body of Christ prays for and with one another. So I would like to share a couple of ways that I'm aware of how we can be praying for one another before turning to God in prayer. We had the tremendous joy yesterday of celebrating Easter with the children of this church. Our kindergartners told the Easter story here in the sanctuary, and I don't think I'll ever forget the disciples saying together, "Can you believe it?" What an authentic and beautiful reaction to the good news of the resurrection. We also celebrate with Anna Mistretta and Jason Fischel on the birth of their child, Wiley Alexander, and with Mary Neal and Ryan Bailey on the birth of their daughter, Sloane Ray. I'd also like to share that Covenant's Room in the Inn season has come to a close as of last week. 176 neighbors were served, which is simply beautiful. And we recognize that the close of a Room in the Inn season is not a close to the experience of the neighbors who stayed here. So we ask for your continued prayers for these folks and for all in the Charlotte community. There are several folks listed in your bulletin requesting healing prayer. That is Sybil Campbell and Nate Doty. So we ask that you hold them and all those in need of healing in prayer this week. Of course, there are numerous other celebrations and concerns. In fact, I'm sure each of you has some combination of the two of those things within your heart. So trusting that God has space for all of it, would you please join your hearts with mine in prayer? God of new life, the resurrection is simply astounding. Some might say it's the greatest story ever told. We know it as the greatest truth ever claimed, as the most profound gift ever received, as the most beautiful mystery to behold. Standing in the light of truth, holding the mysterious gift of resurrection, we bring to you our truths with the prayer that you'd meet us with grace that resurrects, love that overcomes, patience that perseveres, hope and trust that know no end. Oh God, on this Easter Sunday, we grab hold of new life in both tangible and intangible ways. Look at those tulips, we say. Behold this new baby. Our sins have been forgiven. He is risen. Indeed, new life comes in so many shapes and sizes, and yet there is one common denominator, you. And so we offer to you our thanks and praise this Easter day for the blessing of friendship, which resurrects us from places of isolation through the goodness of reciprocal relationship and protected vulnerability. for the backdrop of creation, a divine palette of color, scent, and sound, patterned in its seasons to remind us that life is stronger than death. Thank you for the simple delights that punctuate our days, for handholds that turn into love squeezes, for giggles across the dinner table, for the exchange of gratitude and kindness between two strangers. In the minutiae of our days, might we always have eyes to see where it is that your grace and love have broken in like the morning dawn. We notice it so clearly in the faithful commitment of Jody Malone, in the birth of Wiley Alexander and Sloan Ray, and in the precious voices of our children proclaiming the good news. God of new life, some of us still wait for dawn. Some of us wait for the eyes to see that the stone has been rolled away. And so where darkness lingers and where grief seems to grow, show up. Like you did to Mary, stand before the weeping. Stand before the brokenhearted. Stand before the confused and conflicted, the downtrodden and the needy. Stand before war-torn lands and hungry families. Stand before those in hospice and in hospitals, before their caretakers and loved ones. Stand before Sybil and Nate, for all those in need of healing. Stand before every child, grown and growing, declaring to them their belovedness, especially before those whom the world has tried to tell otherwise. Stand before us all, you, our resurrected God, so that we might see and know that any darkness we know this day is not the darkness of the tomb, it is the darkness of the womb. For in you, and through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, we too are promised life. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It is a good day in the life of the church and the life of the world where we claim Christ's victory over death and we recall the particular stories in the Gospels of his encountering death. The Gospels tell of another time and when Jesus encountered some of the divisions and the death that had crossed his land and his time. And they tell a story when Jesus purposely crossed all religious and all political and all ethnic boundaries by going to a town in Samaria. The town's name was Nablus. You may know the story, but when he went into Nablus, he encountered a woman there who was of, shall we say, dubious moral repute. He engaged her in a conversation, literally at the town watering hole. He welcomed her invitation to go back to her home and share a meal, much to his disciples' dismay. But he did it to show the expansive nature of God's love, to put a stake in the ground that God's love transcends every boundary. Now, I share this morning on Easter morning because on Christmas Eve, you all generously supported a special offering to support a feeding program for refugee Palestinian children in that same town, in Nablus. And that is a town that is now under vigorous military occupation. And as you'll see at the end of a video we're about to show, our mission partner there, through your generosity, purchased food and gathered it up in boxes and sent it home with children to their families who are literally starving under military occupation in their refugee camps. And after receiving our offering, our mission partner there sent us this message. Let's see if we can hear it.
Dear Bob, there's nothing or no words can express my gratitude to know you and no covenant. Thank you very much for the money you sent, guys. in behalf of every kid and a woman in our center, we send you thank you. I'm speechless. Thank you. Thank you very much. I really, really, I don't know what to say. Love you all. Thank you very much.
So I join them in giving thanks for your generosity, and I'm honored to serve a congregation that is vigorously committed to transcending the divisions that often divide us. And when they do divide us, those divisions disproportionately affect those who are vulnerable, and especially children. So all that is to say is that when you give to Covenant, you do important things in the world, and we're grateful.
Shame is a prison as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber, and he's come to take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound,
Hear now the Easter story as it's told by the Gospel of John. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them,
"They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him."
Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. And they said to her,
"Woman, why are you weeping?"
"They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him."
When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her,
"Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?"
Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him,
"Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away."
"Mary."
"Rabboni."
"Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'"
Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples,
"I have seen the Lord."
And she told them that he had said these things to her. May God add understanding and insight to this word. Early on that first Easter morning, all the guys had hightailed it out of there, but not Mary Magdalene. Mary showed up. She came, she saw, she became scared half to death. Then she saw Jesus standing there, and then she thought he was the gardener. You have to wonder whether she was ever able to live that down. If her friends were like any other friends I know, for the rest of her life, especially after they had a beer or two in them, they would say, "Hey, Mary, remember that time you mistook Jesus for the gardener?" And then they'd all laugh and shake their heads, still not really knowing what to make of this astonishing story. It's understandable, really. I still find it hard to come to terms with this story. And so every Easter, I consider what new word, what new insight, what angle I might offer to make this story sear our hearts and anchor our souls. Because truth be told, in this world in which we are experiencing every kind of crisis, political, environmental, immigration, educational, the meaning of Easter can feel pretty elusive. To capture it, some resort to talk of caterpillars and butterflies. Others point to spring crocuses or flowering dogwoods. Music captures Easter well for me, and I thank the worship team for their exquisite offering today. But the truth is, we all need something that is more than mere words. We need a metaphor, an image, a melody that codifies the Easter message for us, because the Easter bunny, can we be honest about this, just is not sufficient. So when I was a boy, Easter was less about church and more about chocolate, solid milk chocolate, please, and that and getting a new tie. Because even if we couldn't capture the meaning and message of Easter in words, we knew something about Easter called for celebration. And that's what will happen all over the world today. Churches across the globe will display beautiful lilies, and they'll hire brass quintets, and they'll polish the silver, and women will don fabulous dresses, and they'll pull out fashionable shoes, even the men. We'll do whatever it is that men do to try to impress those around them, because something deep inside knows that we need the message that Easter brings. We need a word of new life, a word of hope, a word of fresh beginnings. And it's ironic, really, because the way the Gospels tell it, Easter is anything but fancy. In fact, the way the Gospels tell it, Easter is downright messy. It's less a story of flowers and bunnies and more a story about flesh and dirt and bodies and confusion and the way that God never seems to conform to our expectations. That's why when Mary Magdalene, who by some accounts was quite the imperfect woman, visited the tomb, when she visited the tomb, she didn't encounter a perfect Jesus. I mean, no offense to gardeners, but Jesus couldn't have been looking very snappy that morning if his good friend Mary mistook him for the local landscaping help. So he probably still had dirt under his fingers from his own tomb. And that's a lot different than the depictions of Jesus to which we're accustomed. In the 1500s, a famous artist named Raphael depicted Jesus as floating above all of creation, unblemished by his recent crucifixion, and now triumphant and holding the Christian church flag. And about this same time, Tintoretto portrayed a muscular Jesus reigning above angels and crowds, again about to wave a banner of victory over the whole world. But the point of this is that none of them show the scars on his hands or the dirt under his fingernails, and who can blame them? I don't want a disheveled Savior. And I don't imagine you do either. Most of us are already disheveled enough. We don't need Jesus' help to be more so. But the problem is, if we clean Jesus up, if we make him all anodyne and antiseptic, we end up with a skewed understanding of what resurrection really looks like. So this year, I'd like to start the story over from the beginning and wonder if you will do that with me for just a moment. It goes like this. Once upon a time, the God of the universe was basically fed up with how humans imagined him. Distant, capricious, a touch vindictive. In short, the intemperate kind of God that we might be if we happened to inhabit God's throne and his power. I mean, who among us, at least on occasion, hasn't wanted a sudden infusion of divine power to set the world to right, to rectify some deep wrong in Palestine, in the Ukraine, at the border? So at that time, over 2,000 years ago, God's desire to be accurately known overflowed the heavens and was made manifest in an insignificant peasant girl named Mary. And when the time came for her to give birth to God, there was no room in our expectations, no room in our sanctuaries, no rooms in our governance halls or our healthcare centers. So God was born in straw and dirt, and he grew up. This Jesus of Nazareth did. He left home and recruited some, well, let's be honest, less than impressive characters to follow him. Fishermen, tax collectors, rumored sex workers, people with no teeth from bad neighborhoods, Miley Cyrus, Tucker Carlson, few zealots named James and John. They certainly would have ridden motorcycles in that day. If you think I'm kidding, you can read it again for yourselves. It's all right there. These people, they were just questionable at their very best. So then with this band of misfits, Jesus went about the countryside, turning water into wine, and he ate with all the wrong people, and he cast out demons, and he angered the religious establishment, and he insisted that in him, something called the kingdom of God had come near, that through him was coming the world according to God's desires, God's priorities, God's wants and wishes were entering our time and our lives. And so he touched the unclean, and he used dirt and spittle to heal people. He said the wildest destabilizing things like, oh, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first, and the peacemakers are blessed, and the meek shall inherit the earth. He even said to one person, sell all you have and give it to the poor. And one theologian observes that what really cooked people's noodles about Jesus wasn't the question, is Jesus like God? It is, what if God is like Jesus? What if God is not who we thought? What if the most reliable way to know God is not through a religion, not through a divine points program that rewards good behavior with seat upgrades and punishes bad behavior with a, well, let's say a seat on Boeing's spontaneous exit row. What if the most reliable way to know God is through a person? To look at how God chose to reveal God's self in Jesus. Because if that's true, it changes absolutely everything. If what we see in Jesus is God's own self revealed, then what we're dealing with here is a God who, first of all, is really bad at choosing friends, but also a God who would rather die than be in the sin accounting business. A God, now think about this, who would not lift a finger to condemn those who crucified him and went to the depths of hell for the sake of his betrayers. In other words, this is a God who's just unafraid to get his hands dirty for the ones he loves. This is a God who rises to new life with dirt still under his fingernails and chooses a woman with quite a sultry past to go tell everyone about it. So while we may try to clean up Jesus on Easter and make the whole enterprise sparkle and shine, the God of the resurrection, the God who brings new life out of death, isn't satisfied with making things look good on nice. On Easter, we remember that God isn't about making us spit and polish. God is about making us new. And new doesn't always look perfect. Even if we find that flawless dress and that perfect pastel tie. Because like the Easter story, new can be messy. New, well, it looks like recovering alcoholics. New looks like reconciliation between family members, none of whom deserve it. New looks like every time I manage to admit that I was wrong, sometimes harmfully so, and every time I manage not to mention that I was right. New looks like every fresh start. It looks like every act of forgiveness. New is the thing you never saw coming, never really wanted, but needed all along, and it happens to all of us. Easter is the astonishing proclamation that God keeps reaching down into the dirt of our humanity and pulling us up out of the graves that we dig for ourselves with our deception and our violence, and our relentless selfishness, our addictions. You can name your particular brand of sin and brokenness. You know it, what exactly it is. God keeps reaching into whatever grave we have made for ourselves and loving us back to life over and over. So yes, now, even today, with wars raging all over the globe and political mayhem in our country and stress in our cities, and brokenness in our homes, and pain in our hearts, and death on our doorstep, even and especially now, Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by his own death, and bestowing life in those tombs that we dig for ourselves. And this morning, I invite you to defiantly believe it with me. For Jesus Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. All thanks be to God. Amen.
Please rise as we sing together in Christ alone.
Fiercest drought and storm, what
Christ alone.
In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love in righteousness, stored by the ones he
as an Easter people, knowing that whatever death we experience, Christ comes into that grave and meets us and raises us to new life. Go in peace.
Now. between us.